Senator Marco Rubio has been keeping a low profile since dropping out of the presidential race in March, but now he is talking about Donald Trump's rise to become the GOP's presumptive nominee. Rubio sat down today with our CNN colleague Jake Tapper.
There's this claim from the Trump campaign that advisors of yours have been pitching you hard to the Trump campaign to be his running mate, that you really want the job, according to these Trump campaign officials talking about these advisors. What's your position on this?
Well, it would be impossible because I don't really have very many advisors around. Our campaign is no longer running. And unless they've been talking to my wife, which is my critical advisor these
days. Does she want you to be Mr. Trump?
Like I said yesterday, look, I think Donald has won. He's the presumptive nominee at this point. But he'd be best served by having someone, not just by the way a vice presidential nominee, but active surrogates who agree with him on his issues. My differences with Donald, both my reservations about his campaign and my policy differences with him, are well documented, and they remain. And I think he would be best served by having people close to him and his campaign that are enthusiastic about the things he stands for.
You have raised concerns throughout the campaign, ones that you're standing by, about his temperament and about his views on foreign policy, on trade policy, and other things. Would those reservations keep you? Do they right now preclude you from endorsing him?
Well, I've signed a pledge that said I'd support the Republican nominee, and I intend to continue to do that. But here's a situation that we're in. On the one hand, I don't want Hillary Clinton to be the president of the United States. I don't want her to win this election. On the other hand, as I said, I have well-defined differences with the presumptive nominee of the Republican Party. And like millions of Republicans, you try to reconcile those two things. I intend to live up to the pledge that we made. But that said, these concerns that I have about policy, they remain and they're there. But, you know, that doesn't mean that Donald needs to change his positions in order to get my support or what have you. As I said earlier today, I think he should be true to what he believes in and continue to campaign on those things and make his case to the American people.
But it's not just concerns that you've had about him. You once said that you didn't think it would, that you had concerns about the fact, about the nuclear codes being in the hands of an erratic con man. That was what you said.
Well, here's what I'm not going to do over the next 6 months is sit there and just be taking shots at him. He obviously wasn't my first choice because I was running for president. He has won the nomination. And now he deserves the opportunity to go out and make his case to the American people. And that's what he's going to do. I don't view my role over the next 6 months to just sit here and level charges against him. I know what I said during the campaign. I enunciated those things repeatedly. And the voters chose a different direction. I stand by the things that I said, but I'm not going to sit here now and become his chief critic over the next 6 months because he deserves the opportunity to go forward and make his argument and try to win.
Mr. Trump is going to meet with Republican leaders, including Paul Ryan, on Thursday. What is he going to need to do to get more Republicans on board? More specifically, what is he going to need to do to get you to say, I support Donald Trump to be president? Because you're not saying that. You say, I signed a pledge and I will honor the pledge. But you're not saying the words, I support Donald Trump.
Let's begin with the premise that this has been a very unusual election cycle, unlike anything we've ever seen before. And so I don't know if there's a well-established roadmap forward in terms of how to do that. I think significant public policy differences will remain between now and the election. But I do think it's smart that he's coming to D.C., that he's meeting with the leaders of our party. And I think that's part of that process. And we'll see where we are in 2 months and 3 months and 4 months. I'm not asking him to change his position on. I'd like him to change his position on some issues. But I think he has won the primary based on a given set of things that he has stood for. In my sense, he's going to continue to stand for those things.
It's being put out there by the Cruz campaign that they tried to get you to be his running mate earlier in the process in March. They reached out and they had polled, and it seemed like a Cruz-Rubio ticket with him at the top of the ticket would have been able to stop Donald Trump, and they fault you for not taking that opportunity.
Well, look, I don't know who put that out there. I talked to Ted the day after the Florida primary when I had dropped out. He didn't say a word about VP or anything of that nature. I also, quite frankly, think it's an unfortunate story, given Carly Fiorina worked really hard for his campaign. She did a lot of hard work, and the story kind of implies that she wasn't their first choice. I think that's unfair to her. And whoever put that out really was a classless move when it comes to Carly. But I think that story is largely inaccurate in terms of any outreach to me.
Okay. The people who told me the story, I'm the one that wrote the story, said that like they had reached out through emissaries and it came back to them that you were not interested.
Well, there may be people out there were talking about it, but I spoke to Ted personally the day after the election and that topic never came up.
Would it have worked?
I don't believe it would have. I don't think you win by doing those sorts of things. The bottom line is, whether we like it or not, Donald has been able to tap into a sense in this country millions of Americans, that they're being left behind by massive transitions in our economy, compounded by an economic meltdown in 2008, compounded by 8 years of Barack Obama's policies that have left Americans feeling that America is weaker in the world. And he was able to tap into that successfully to become the nominee. And you know, that's the reality of what we face. And I'm not sure that after a certain point in this campaign, anything would have stopped that.
Are you saying definitively you would never serve as his vice president if he asked?
Who's that?
Donald Trump. I'm sorry, Donald Trump.
Because we had just asked.
Right, sorry.
So, no. I mean, he needs to appoint someone to be his vice presidential nominee that more fully embraces the things he stands for.
You mean, no, you're not interested?
Absolutely.
No,
yeah, and again, to be frank, I mean, I've never had those conversations with anyone in his campaign. So I'm not saying that anyone's offered it to me or it's been suggested to me. I'm just saying to you that I believe he would be best served by someone who more fully embraces the things he stands for, and that's certainly not me.